Every year, the Victoria's Secret Fashion Show broadcasts to millions of viewers. A flurry of top models, called angels, strut down the runway in sexy lingerie next to famous pop stars belting their best songs. It's a visual celebration of the top lingerie retailer in the United States, which consistently captures around 60% of the market.
I get all my bras and underwear from Victoria's Secret.
You know, when I go in the store, I feel so special, like it's a holiday for me when I go shopping.
Más el rosa, la purpurina, todo lo que te transporta. Es como llevas Victoria's Secret y dices, fíjate, me siento sexy, me siento empoderada, no sé.
But lately, Victoria's Secret seems to be losing some of its magic. Just look at the fashion show's ratings, which have steadily fallen since 2011 to a historic low of 3.3 million in 2018. See, there's a widening chasm between what Victoria's Secret sells as sexy and what most women look like, and between Victoria's Secret products and what most women want in bras and underwear. Victoria's Secret's annual same-store sales have fallen 3 years in a row, and the stock value of its parent company, L Brands, fell by 55% in 2018. So what was the secret to Victoria's prior success, and will they find it again? Let's start with the basics. Victoria's Secret is one of several brands owned by the parent company, L Brands. Victoria's Secret is the largest retailer under L Brands, making up around 60% of the company's total sales, and 35% of that is just bras. This L stands for The Limited, the name of the company's first brand. Businessman Leslie Wexner founded The Limited in 1963 as a clothing store that brought the fashionability of Europe and America's coastal cities to the women of the Midwest. By 1979, The Limited had gone public and opened 318 stores across the nation. In the early 1980s, Wexner visited one of his stores in San Francisco. While there, he stumbled upon a curious shop, a lingerie retailer called Victoria's Secret. See, retail of ladies' undergarments today is very different than how it used to be. American women typically viewed their undergarments on a binary, strictly functional for day-to-day, or fancy and sexy for special occasions. Because of this relatively low demand, lingerie was relegated to dusty corners on the second floors of department stores. That's what Victoria's Secret's founder, Roy Raymond, wanted to change. Raymond opened the first Victoria's Secret in Palo Alto in 1977. By the time Wexner discovered one in 1982, Raymond had opened four more stores in San Francisco. The five stores combined made $6 million in sales that year. But still, the stores were struggling. Raymond's business rested on his idea that men, like him, bought lingerie for the women in their lives. So he curated his stores for men's tastes, dark colors, leather sofas, racy garments. But the men weren't buying much, and their wives found the lingerie they did buy uncomfortable and unappealing. So by 1982, Victoria's Secret was on the verge of bankruptcy. Wexner saw an opportunity to do for lingerie what The Limited had done for clothing, so he bought Victoria's Secret for about $1 million. Wexner set to work to transform the undergarment habits of American women. He constructed standard supportive bras, but spiced them up with vivid colors and distinctive prints. He redesigned the stores to be reminiscent of a 19th century English boudoir, using softer, more feminine colors. He wanted to create a store where the sexiest women in the world would buy lingerie, and then invite regular women to partake in this glamorous fantasy, for a steep price tag. It worked, and it worked partly because women worked.
The power suit was important then, and they wore little teddies because that was like a sexy layer underneath the jacket. Even though she was wearing a power suit and she was in the workforce, she still wanted to wear something that was sexy and appropriate for her figure.
See, Victoria's Secret entered the market in the 1980s, right when women raised with many revolutionary ideas were entering the workforce. The sexual revolution encouraged them to embrace their own sexiness. The workplace revolution meant that millions more of them had disposable income, and they didn't spend that disposable income on weddings or babies because they increasingly delayed those choices. So they spent it on bras, at least enough to propel Victoria's Secret to early success. By 1986, the retailer had 100 stores across the country and was stealing market share from department stores. 9 years later, it had 670 stores nationwide and produced $1.9 billion in sales.
So you saw the elevation of the brand correspond with the elevation of what was happening culturally in terms of women exercising their own power, their own feminist movement, and their own rights. And Victoria's Secret was able to capitalize on that.
But even with all this success, women's shopping habits hadn't significantly changed. Women hadn't yet bought the idea that they should spend more on a fancier bra for daily use. So for the rest of the 90s, Victoria's Secret searched for a bra that could straddle the line between function and beauty. Three major attempts flopped, either for sacrificing structure for beauty or for just baffling advertising. It wasn't until 1999 that Wexner found a hit, the Body by Victoria line. Following consumer intelligence, Wexner created this bra to be seamless and padded with soft, luxurious fabric. Body by Victoria sold more than 2.5 times the bras of any other line launched by Victoria's Secret in its first 4 weeks. Though the bras sold for more than double the price of the average department store bra, the line was nearly sold out 6 weeks after launching. This was the beginning of Victoria's Secret's path to dominating the intimate apparel industry. The company expanded rapidly. It started cosmetic and fragrance lines. It launched the brand Pink in 2004 to appeal to younger women with trendy bras, underwear, and loungewear. Meanwhile, the annual fashion show became a ratings powerhouse. It drew 12.4 million viewers in 2001 when it moved to network television, and it launched the careers of now supermodels like Heidi Klum, Gisele Bündchen, Adriana Lima, and Tyra Banks. By 2006, one out of every three purchases in the intimate apparel industry came from a Victoria's Secret. That year, Wexner named Sharon Turney, longtime leader of the brand's catalog division, as the new CEO. In 2010 and 2011, same-store sales grew at 14%, and in 2012, Victoria's Secret was crowned the most buzzed-about apparel brand in the U.S. But this is also where the retailer began to slip. It started slowly. Same-store sales fell to 7% in 2012 and just 3% for the next 2 years. This number bounced back to 5% in 2015, but then CEO Turney rattled the company again when she abruptly resigned in 2016. Wexner stepped in to make changes. First, Wexner restructured the company and laid off 200 employees. He installed a new CEO, Jan Singer, who previously headed up the shapewear brand Spanx. Next, Victoria's Secret slimmed its offerings. It shuttered both its swimsuit and catalog businesses. The ending of the swimsuit line especially worried investors. Though it had trended downward for a few years, it still comprised roughly $500 million of L Brand's revenue. But the company sacrificed it to focus on its core lingerie line and expand its athleisure offerings. These changes came late. Both the lingerie and athleisure markets had seen major shifts in the preceding years, and other, younger brands had already established themselves as retailers whose products and messaging more accurately reflect these shifts. Think Aerie, Third Love, and celebrity lines like Rihanna's Savage by Fenty, Kate Hudson's Fabletics, and Beyoncé's Ivy Park. Their success underlines a major problem for Victoria's Secret. The retailer, once heralded as a revolutionary, is falling behind the times. Let's look at how. First, women increasingly prioritize comfort and a more natural look.
The whole attitude or prescription of sexiness is very different today than it was, I would say, 5 years ago. Comfort is the key word here.
On the lingerie side, women want to swap their wired, padded push-up bras for comfortable bralettes, bandeaus, and bodysuits. By the time Victoria's Secret introduced bralettes in 2016, the market was already crowded with brands like Aerie, Third Love, and Soma. Aerie especially hit the mark with younger consumers. Its annual same-store sales have increased by double digits each year since 2015. On the athleisure side, Victoria's Secret was again late to the game. Athleisure's market value grew by over 40% from 2013 to 2018, as women sported yoga pants to coffee shops, grocery stores, and sometimes actual yoga classes. So when Victoria's Secret introduced its athleisure line in 2016, it had to contend with existing behemoths like Lululemon and Nike. Lululemon, a mecca for yoga pants enthusiasts, has increased its overall sales and profit every year since it went public in 2007. Second, a growing movement to represent all types of people and bodies has gone mainstream.
They're not very diverse and you don't get that much representation there, so I'd rather shop somewhere where I can like see myself.
Like the glamorous, the perfect body, the perfect color, I don't rely to it.
Victoria's Secret's competitors increasingly emphasize racial, body, and gender inclusivity in their messaging. Just look at these ads from Ivy Park and Aerie featuring transgender star Laverne Cox and plus-size model Iskra Lawrence. When speaking to Vogue about her new lingerie line, megastar Rihanna described herself as not built like a Victoria's Secret girl. But Victoria's Secret clings to its angels, who epitomize the slim yet busty, bombshell look that consumers increasingly shun as unrealistic and demeaning.
So you see these fantastical things coming down the catwalk and women can't relate to it.
Victoria's Secret found itself in hot water when Chief Marketing Officer Ed Razek implied in a 2018 Vogue interview that neither plus size nor transgender models could sell the Victoria's Secret fantasy. Writers and Twitter users slammed the retailer, calling it and its show outdated, transphobic, and more. And Victoria's Secret competitor Third Love called out the brand in a full-page ad in the New York Times. Razek later apologized, stating the show is open to casting transgender models. Finally, Victoria's Secret could face a backlash from consumers who increasingly care about company ethics. A 2018 Mintel report notes that 97% of US consumers think it's at least somewhat important that companies behave ethically, up from 76% in 2012. Victoria's Secret consistently rates poorly on the annual Ethical Fashion Report and has faced a slew of accusations over the years, including reports of child and slave labor. CNBC reached out to Victoria's Secret for comment, but they declined. After the rocky last 2 years, analysts and investors worry for L Brand's falling angel. L Brand's continued sales growth is now thanks to its other popular brand, Bath & Body Works. The brand is now trying a few tactics to turn this trend around. First, they plan to re-enter the swimsuit category, as well as others they've abandoned. Second, they pursue collaborations with brands like UGG Boots and fashion designers like Balmain and Mary Catherine Zhu. Finally, the company is looking at paring back its real estate, as analysts have argued it has far too many stores across the country. Still, analysts question if these steps will work. Victoria's Secret doesn't seem to be trying to change its products or messaging to keep up with shifting consumer priorities, at least not as fast or successfully as its competition.
Their product assortment is lacking in terms of understanding what their target audience wants. You know, as a retailer, you have to be nimble. Victoria's Secret is still trying to appeal to the men of the Mad Men era, and that's over.